Since you are as handsome as any of them, Mr. Bingley might like you the best.
I certainly have had my share of good looks in the past, Mr. Bent, but I do not believe to be anything extraordinary now. When a woman has as many grown-up daughters as I have, she ought to give over thinking her own beauty.
In such cases, a woman has not much beauty to think of.
Mr. Bent!
She'll heartily consent to whichever of the girls you choose. I must throw in a good word for my Lizzie.
I desire you will do no such thing. Lizzie is not half so handsome as Jane, nor half so good-humoured as Lydia, nor as lively as Kitty, nor as accomplished as Mary, yet you are always giving her the preference.
They are all silly and ignorant like other girls, but Lizzie has more quickness than her sisters.
Father,
how can you abuse your own children in such a way? You take delight in vexing me. You have no compassion for my poor nerves.
On the contrary, Mrs. Bennet, I have a high respect for your nerves. They are my old friends.
Mary! Enough! Consider your daughters, Mr. Bennet. Think what an establishment Mr. Bingley would be for one of them. Lady Lucas is determined to visit Mr. Bingley on behalf of her daughter Charlotte, and she merely entertains newcomers!
Lady Lucas is a generous mother.
She is a selfish, hypocritical woman, and I have no opinion of her.
For what do we live? But to make sport of our neighbours and to laugh at them in our turn.
Ta-da!
I hope Mr. Bingley will like it, Lydia.
We are not to know what Mr. Bingley likes since we are not to visit him.
But you forget, Mama, we should meet him at the assembly.
Don't cough, Kitty! Have some compassion on my nerves!
I don't cough for my own amusement.
When is your next ball to be, Lizzie?
Tomorrow, Papa.
Oh. There you have it, Mr. Bennet. No time for a prior acquaintance with Mr. Bingley.
What say you, Mary? You are a young lady of deep reflection and read a great many books. While Mary's adjusting her ideas, let us return to Mr. Bingley.
I am sick of Mr. Bingley.
Well, why didn't you tell me so before? If I had have known half as much this morning, certainly would not have called on him.
Good to see you, my dear Mr. Bennet.
Now, Kitty, you may cough as much as you choose.
What an excellent father you girls have. I do not know how you'll make amends for his kindness. Lydia, my love, though you are the youngest, I dare say Mr. Bingley will dance with you at the ball. To be fond of dancing is certainly the first step towards falling in love.
Myself, but I feel the air of London never quite agrees with me.
beg your pardon, madam.
It's my fault, sir. Ah, Miss Elizabeth Bennett, a very desirable dancing partner for you, sir.
Please don't think I stumbled as we're in search for partners, Sylvia.
You're not going to dance?
I am determined to decline.
Oh, cruelty. Thy name is woman.
Come, Darcy. I must have you dance. I had to see you about by yourself in this stupid manner.
I most certainly shall not. You know how I detest it. Besides, there's not a woman in this room who would not be a punishment to me to dance with.
I've never met with so many pleasant girls in my life. Several of them are uncommonly pretty.
You are dancing with a handsome girl in the room.
Oh, she is the most beautiful creature I ever beheld. But there is one of her sisters. Very pretty, too, and I dare say agreeable.
Which do you mean? She's tolerable, but not handsome to tempt to me. No, here's a collection of people in whom there's little beauty and so less fashion, but one of whom I have the slightest interest in.
10,000 a year or not, Mr. Bingley's friend is the most proudest little man in the world. I quite detest him.
His rank entitles him to live well of himself. He is of a respectable family, sister.
And what do you think of Mr. Bingley?
Oh, my dear, I'm so excessively happy with him. He is so handsome and has something to say to everybody. That is my idea of a good breeding.
Mr. Bingley is just what a young man ought to be. Sensible, good-humoured, lively, and I never saw such happy manners.
Well, I give you leave to like him. You've liked many a stupider person.
Dear Lizzie.
This is true. I've never heard you speak ill of anybody in your life.
I always speak what I think.
Which is what makes it a wonder, to be so honestly blind to the follies of others. Charlotte!
Lizzie!
Isn't this fun? So many men. You know what follows.
You do not know how,
Charlotte.
Mr. Darcy?
Miss Bingley? Your brother dances finally?
Which is more than I can say for you. I guess it's your thoughts.
Really?
You're considering how insupportable it would be to spend many more evenings in such society. And indeed, I'm quite of your opinion. He's never more annoyed. The insipidity and yet the noise. The nothingness and yet the self-importance of all these people.
No, I assure you, my mind was more agreeably engaged. Meditating on the very great pleasure that a pair of fine eyes in the face of a pretty woman would bestow.
Oh? And what lady inspires such reflections?
A Miss Elizabeth Bennett.
Miss Elizabeth Bennett? I am all astonishment. How long has she been such a favorite? When am I to wish your joy in matrimony?
A lady's imagination is very rapid. It jumps from admiration to love, from love to matrimony in a moment.
You'll have a charming mother-in-law indeed. And you'd have to kill the young girls running after the officers.
God, to dine in Netherfield with Mr. Bingley's party?
On Friday night.
Oh, well, you must accept him, you must.
And there might be officers there too.
Officers? I do remember when I quite liked to redcoat myself. If a smart young colonel with 5 or 6,000 a year should want one of my girls.
Can I have the carriage?
No, my dear, you better call a horseback.
Aye.
Because then if it rains, you will have to stay all night.
Mama!
With any luck, it will be a terrible day.
Well, my dear, if your daughter should die, it would be a comfort to know that it was all in pursuit of Mr. Bingley.
La, I am not afraid of her all dying. People do not die of trifling colds. All will be well as long as she stays there. Oh, how he danced with her. All evening, too. He thought her quite beautiful. He danced the first two with her, then the next with Charlotte Lucas, which vexed me. However, he did not admire her. Nobody can, not that I think. Charlotte's so very plain. Then he danced the next two with Lizzie, then another with another chick, and then Jane.
If he had any compassion for me, he certainly would not have danced half so much.
Whatever can you mean, Mr. Bennett?
That he had sprained his ankle in the first dance.
I shall go to her.
Who?
Jane.
Oh.
But we have no spare horses.
Then I shall walk.
In this weather, are you mad?
The rain has eased.
The mad! You will not be fit to be seen when you get there!
I shall be fit to be seen by Jane. It is no more than 3 miles. I shall be back by dinner.
I have read that an excursion should always be in proportion to what is required.
And I will go as
still see something of the officers.
Officers?
Officers.
There was a fine new regiment in Meryton. Their officers were present at the ball.
Oh, they danced with us, Papa, 3 or 4 times.
The army, a profession which means to bring obscure person into undue distinction. I should be sorry to see any daughter of mine marrying an officer.
She almost looked wild, very nonsensical to come at all. Why must she be scamping about the countryside because her sister has a cold? Her hair so untidy, so blousy, and her petticoat 6 inches deep in mud.
I thought Miss Bennet looked remarkably well. The dirty petticoat quite set my remark.
You observed it, Mr. Darcy. You won't want to see your sister make such an exhibition.
Certainly not.
To walk 3 miles, or 4 miles, or 5 miles, whatever it is, above her ankles in dirt. And alone, quite alone. What could she mean by it? It seems to me to show an abominable sort of independence, a most country town indifference to decorum.
Her face.
I'm afraid, Mr. Darcy, that this adventure has rather affected your admiration for Miss Elizabeth Bennet's fine eyes.
They were brightened by the exercise.
Then you shall have a portrait in your gallery at Pemberley.
No.
Could no painter do justice to those beautiful eyes?
It'd not be easy to catch the expression, but the color and shape, the eyelashes so remarkably fine, might be copied.
She is so coarse!
She's rather energetic. No miraculous consequence of living in the country and having a fondness of the out-of-doors.
Cannot see any beauty in her. Her face is too thin, her complexion has no brilliancy, and her features are not at all handsome. Which in her air altogether is a self-sufficiency without fashion. Which is intolerable. She a beauty? I should soon call her mother a wit.
Caroline! But her sister, Jane.
Jane Bennet is a really sweet girl, and I wish with all my heart to see her well settled. But with such a mother and such low connections, I am afraid there's no chance of it.
It does not make their daughters one jot less agreeable.
But it must materially lessen their chances of marrying into consideration, the world.
About to play cards. Would you join us?
You are charming in groups, and pitch would be spoiled by any four.
Miss Eliza despises cards. I dare say she's a great reader and has no pleasure in doing anything else.
I deserve none of such praise nor such censure. I am not a great reader, and I take pleasure in many things.
In nursing your sister, I'm sure you have pleasure, and I'll be soon hope it'll be increased by seeing your pipeline.
Thank you, Mr. Bingley.
Now, let me fetch you all the books that my modest library affords.
I declare that there is no enjoyment like reading. When I have a house of my own, I shall be miserable if I have not an excellent library.
I wish my collections were larger, but I am an idle fellow, and though I have not many books, I have more than I ever look into.
What a delightful library you have at Pemberley, Mr. Darcy.
It's been the work of many generations.
Come, come, you've added so much to it. You're always buying books.
I cannot comprehend the neglect of a family library in such days as these.
And has your sister much grown since we saw her last?
Now nearing Miss Elizabeth Bennet's height.
Oh, how I long to see her. I've never met with anybody who has delighted me so much. Such countenance, such manners, and extremely accomplished for her age.
It is amazing to me how all young ladies can have the patience to be accomplished as they are.
All young ladies are accomplished, my dear Charles. What do you mean?
They all paint tables, cover screens, and purses. I'm sure I've never heard of a young lady without first being informed that she was very
I cannot boast knowing more than half a dozen, and my entire range of acquaintance are truly accomplished.
Well, then you must expect a great deal in your ideal of an accomplished woman.
I do. A woman must have thorough knowledge of music, singing, dancing, drawing, and the modern languages. She must possess a certain something in her air and manner of walking, the tone of her voice, her dress, and expressions. All this she must possess, and to all this she must add something more substantial, by the improvement of her mind through extensive reading.
I now no longer wonder at your knowing six accomplishments. I now rather wonder at your knowing any.
Are you so severe upon your sex?
I never saw such capacity and elegance and taste as you describe united in any such one woman.
I must protest that I know many women who answer to this description. My dear Liza, I hope you're not one of those young ladies who seek to recommend themselves to the other sex by unveiling their own.
My dear Mrs. Bennett.
Mrs. Bennett, did you walk here too?
Certainly not. My husband keeps a horse and coach for the most trivial of journeys.
We're honored by your company, and I'll be soon. And I hope you'll not find Miss Bennett worse than expected.
A great deal worse, I may hope. I suspect she is too ill to be moved. She must trespass a little longer on your kindness.
Miss Bennett shall receive every possible attention while she remains with us.
I am sure if it were not for such good friends, I do not know what will become of her, for she must be very ill indeed and suffering a vast deal, though with the greatest patience, for she is the sweetest temper. I often tell my other girls that they are nothing to her. You have a fine room here, Mr. Bingley, though you have but a short lease. I do not hope you think of quitting it in a hurry.
Whatever I do is done in a hurry. Therefore, if I do resolve to quit Netherfield, I should be probably off in 5 minutes. At present, however, I consider myself fixture.
Beware that Meryton society does not consider you a fixture, Mr. Bingley, but then you shall never be able to depart.
Lizzie, remember where you are and do not run on that wild manner that you are so suffered to at home.
In the country neighborhood, you live in a very confined and unvarying society.
But people themselves offer so much that you can observe them forever.
Certainly. I assure you there is much of that going on in town as there is in the country. But the country is a great deal more pleasanter, is it not, Mr. Bingley?
When I'm in the country, I never wish to leave it. When I'm in the town, it is pretty much the same. They have each their advantages, and I'm equally happy in both.
That is because you have the right disposition. But that gentleman seemed to think that the country was nothing at all.
Indeed, mamma, you quite mistook Mr. Duff. He only meant that there are not such a variety of people in the country as there are in town, which is true.
Certainly, my dear, nobody said there were. But as to not meeting with many people, we regularly dine with 24 families. Well, good day to you, Mr. Bingley. Miss Bingley. I'm grateful for the concern you show, my Jane.
It is from the heart, Mrs. Bennett. I wish you better. And we think of holding a ball at Netherfield for all our neighbours.
A ball?
Good day, Mrs. Bennett. Miss Bennett?
Good day, Mr. Bingley. Good day.
Well, how delighted Miss Darcy will be such a letter. You write uncommonly fast.
You are mistaken. I write rather slowly.
How many letters do you have occasion to write in the course of a year? Letters of business, too. How odious I should think of them.
How fortunate, then, that they fall to my lot, not yours.
Pray, tell your sister that I long to see her.
I've already done so.
Oh? Tell your sister that I'm delighted to hear her improvement on the piano, and let her know that I'm quite enraptured with your beautiful little design of a table.
Would you give me leave to defer your answer so I write again? At present, I have not room to do it justice.
Charles writes in the most careless ways imaginable. He leaves half his words down and blots the rest.
My ideas flow so rapidly that I have not the time to express them, which means sometimes they convey no ideas at all.
Really, you're proud of your defects in writing, proceeding as they do from your repetitive thought, because you think they make you highly interesting.
This is too much. If you're not such a great tool, fellow Darcy, I should not have to pay you half so much deference.
I see you dislike our argument, which is silence matter. Miss Bingley, would you indulge us in some music?
Miss Bennett, you must lead the way.
This is your progress, Miss Bingley.
Bennett, would you care to dance?
I heard what you said the first time, but I cannot immediately determine what to say in reply. You wanted me, I know, to say yes, but you might have the pleasure of despising my scheme. But I know your scheme, and therefore I've made up my mind to say no. Now despise it, if you dare.
I do not dare.
Mr. Darcy is not to be laughed at.
It's been the study of my life to avoid those weaknesses which expose one to ridicule.
Weaknesses such as vanity and pride?
Yes, vanity is a weakness. But pride, where there is real superiority of mind, pride will always be under good regulation.
Darcy has no faults.
I have faults enough. My temper I dare not vouch for, as I believe, too little yielding for the convenience of the world. I cannot forget the vices and follies of others as soon as they ought to know the offenses against myself. My good opinion once lost is lost forever.
That is a failing indeed. But you have chosen your fault well. I cannot laugh at it.
There is, I believe, in everyone the tendency to some natural defect that not even the best of education can overcome.
And yours is to hate everyone.
and yours is willfully to misunderstand them.
By the by, child, are you really serious in holding our dance in Netherfield? I'd advise you before you determine on it to consult the consult the wishes of the present party. There's some amongst us to whom a ball will be more of a punishment than a pleasure.
If you mean Darcy, he may go to bed before it begins if he chooses. As for the ball, it is quite a subtle thing.
I should like balls infinitely. Better if they're carried out in a different manner. They are so tedious, it will be more rational if a conversation instead of dancing made the order of the day.
Much more rational, I dare say. But it wouldn't be so much like ball.
About a month ago, I received this letter, and about a fortnight ago, I answered it. And to this very day, my correspondent arrives for dinner.
But who is it, Papa? Who?
It is from my cousin, Mr. Collins.
Mr. Collins?
Who, because I have no male issue, is next in line to my inheritance and may kick you out of this house as soon as he pleases.
Ray, do not talk of that odious man whom I have never met. I do not think it is the hardest thing in the world that your estate should be tailed away from your own daughters and default of male heirs. It is cruel to settle an estate away from five yet-to-be-married daughters in favour of a man who nobody cares anything about!
Nothing can clear Mr. Collins from inheriting Longbourn. But if you do read his letter, you may perhaps be a little softened.
Dear sir, the disagreement subsisting between yourself and my late honoured father, I seek to heal. Having received ordination at Easter, I have been so fortunate as to be distinguished by the patronage of the Right Honourable Widow, Lady Catherine de Bourgh, whose bounty and generosity has preferred me to the Valedictory on her estate, where it shall be my earnest endeavour to demean myself with grateful respect to her ladyship. As a clergyman, moreover, I feel it my duty to promote and establish the blessing of peace in all families within the reach of my influence, and thus ask that you not reject my olive branch. I assure you of my readiness to make your amiable daughters every possible amends, but of this hereafter. If you should have no objection to receive me into your house, I propose myself the satisfaction of waiting on you and your family Monday, November 18th.
That's today!
By 4 o'clock. And shall trespass in your hospitality till the Saturday night following.
Till Saturday?
I am impatient to see this peace-making gentleman.
The idea of the olive branch is not wholly new, yet I think it is well expressed.
If he be the one to make my daughter's amends, I shall not be the one to discourage him.
He's here!
You have a fine family of daughters, Miss Bennet. I have heard much of their beauty. I do not doubt you seeing them all in due time, well disposed of in marriage.
I hope that may prove so, otherwise they will be destitute enough. Things are settled so oddly.
I am very sensible, madam, to the hardships of my three fair cousins.
Oh, and I have two more elder daughters, Mr. Bennet.
And here they be. Miss Bennet. Miss Bennet.
Mr. Collins, heir to Longbourn.
Ah, dinner. Fish?
Fine house, Miss Bennet.
My cousin is quite as ridiculous as I had hoped.
Mm. highly admirable dinner. I beg to know if which of my fair cousins the excellence of this cooking is owing.
I assure you, Mr. Collins, that we are well able to keep a good cook. My daughters have nothing to do in the kitchen.
I do beg your pardon if I have displeased you.
No offense taken, Mr. Collins.
Please accept my unreserved apologies, Miss Bennet.
No need, Mr. Collins.
Apologies, Miss Bennet. You seem very fortunate in your patroness, Mr. Collins. Indeed, I protest that I have never in my life witnessed such affability in a person of rank as I have done with Lady Catherine. She has asked me twice to dine at Rosa.
You said she is a widow. Has she any family?
She has only one daughter, the heiress of Rosa's, and of very extensive property.
And is she a handsome young lady?
Most charming. She is, unfortunately, of a sickly constitution.
Small your parsonage house, Mr. Collins?
It is a fine house, Miss Bennet. And I have a very sufficient income. I intend to marry, and in short, I have a wife in view.
Mr. Collins!
Daughters, leave the table. Upon seeing your eldest, your lovely face has confirmed my views.
Mr. Collins, I must just caution you against Jane. I must just mention that she's likely soon to be engaged. As to my younger daughters, I cannot positively answer, but I do not know of any preposition.
Then might I not shift from the eldest to the next, equal in birth and beauty?
I trust I may soon have two daughters married.
May I have private audience with Miss Elizabeth?
Now, sir?
Yes, sir.
London! I'm sure Liz can have no objection. I'm very happy.
No, Mama, do not go. I beg you, do not go.
Mr. Collins must excuse me. You know nothing to say to me that anybody need not.
No, Elizabeth, I desire you will stay where you are.
No, Mama.
Elizabeth, listen to what Mr. Collins has to say to you. Mr. Bennet.
Rather adds to your perfections. As soon as I entered this splendid house, did I single you out as the companion of my future life? Every clergyman should set the example of matrimony in his parish. It is, in addition, it will add very greatly to my happiness. It is also the advice and recommendation of my Lady Catherine that I marry as soon as I can, provided I choose with discretion, of course. Your wit and vivacity I think shall be acceptable to her, especially when tempered with the silence and respect that her rank will inevitably excite. And now, nothing remains but to assure you, in the most animated language, of the violence of my affections, though no ungenerous reproach shall ever pass my lips when you are my wife.
You are too hasty, sir. You figured I had made no answer. Let me do so now without further loss of time. First, thank you for the compliment you are paying me. Second, I am very sensible to the honour of your proposals, and third, it is impossible for me to do anything other than decline.
I know it is not unusual for young ladies to reject the advances of the man whom they secretly mean to accept. I am by therefore no means discouraged by what you have just said, and shall hope to lead you to the altar before long.
Your hope is rather extraordinary after my declaration. I wish you very rich and very happy, and by refusing your hand, you are all in my power to prevent you from being otherwise.
It does not appear to me that my hand is unworthy of your acceptance, or that the establishment that I can offer would be anything other than highly desirable. I must therefore conclude you are not serious in your rejection of me.
Can I speak plainer? Think of me not as an elegant female intending to plague you, but as a rational creature speaking from the truth in her heart.
You are uniformly charming, and I am persuaded that my proposal shall be sanctioned by the express authority of your excellent parents.
Congratulations on the happy prospect of your near connection.
Near connection is the truth of it. Miss Elizabeth has refused, naturally, as one of such bashful modesty and genuine delicacy of character would on first proposal.
Oh, Oh, she is a very headstrong, foolish girl and does not know her own interests, but I will make her certain of it, you can depend.
Pardon me for interrupting you, madam. But if she is really headstrong and foolish, I know not whether she would altogether be so very desirable a wife.
Mr. Collins, you quite misunderstand me. Lizzie is as good an aged girl that has ever lived. Mr. Bennet, you're wanted immediately. We are all in an uproar. You must make Lizzie marry Mr. Collins, and if you do not, he will make haste and change his mind and will not have her.
I have not the pleasure of understanding. What are you talking about?
The one won't have the other.
And it seems a hopeless business.
Tell Lizzie that you insist upon marrying Mr. Collins.
Let her be called.
Lizzie!
And I shall retire from this familial scene.
Come here, child. I understand that Mr. Collins has made you an offer in marriage.
It is true, sir.
And this you have refused?
I have, sir.
Your mother insists upon you accepting this. Is this not true, Mrs. Bennet?
Yes, and I will no longer speak to her or talk again. Not that I have much pleasure in talking to anybody. When people suffer from nervous complaints as I do, they cannot have much pleasure in talking.
Well, Elizabeth, an unhappy alternative is before you. Your mother will never speak to you again if you do not marry Mr. Collins. And I will never speak to you again if you do.
She may lose the opportunity of fixing it in 9 cases out of 10. A woman who will show more affection than she feels,
she must first fall in love.
That comes thereafter. Only when she has secured him will it be the leisure of falling in love.
Well, if the object was simply to be well married, to get a rich husband, any rich husband, then I dare say your approach should be adopted. But that is not the path to happiness in marriage.
Happiness in marriage is entirely a matter of chance.
Happiness in marriage? Husband and wife grow sufficiently unlike each other after marriage that naught precedes but vexation.
Mr. Collins.
Miss Bennet.
I'm surprised to see you have accepted an invitation to the nuptial ball, Mr. Collins.
I have danced with all my fair cousins at court this evening. And I take this opportunity of soliciting your hand, Miss Elizabeth. For the next dance, I mean.
Miss Bennet, may I have the honor of your hand in the next dance?
Oh.
Say shall be said.
Change your mind.
progress?
I do not put on at all. It has only exceeded.
Please do not sketch my character at the present moment. It would put no good on either of us.
If I do not do so now, I may never have another opportunity.
But present always occupies you in such scenes, does it?
Yes, always.
My mother bids me by my allow the other ladies to have time to exhibit.
Miss Bennet, may I introduce myself? Wick.
Miss Dorfman. I've seen you before, I think.
I'm but to be stationed here in Hertfordshire. How long has a gentleman with whom you danced with been staying here?
Mr. Darcy, not more than a month.
I wonder whether he is likely to be in this county much longer.
Do you know Mr. Darcy?
Indeed I do.
I have discovered in the room a near relation of my patroness, Lady Catherine de Bourgh. How wonderful these sort of things occur.
Pray who?
And Mr. Darcy.
Mr. Darcy?
Lady Anne and Lady Catherine with the sisters.
You're not going to introduce yourself to Mr. Darcy.
Indeed I am.
I assure you, Mr. Darcy, consider you addressing him now with an introduction and a personal freedom.
My dear Miss Elizabeth, I have the highest opinion in the world of your knowledge in all matters within the scope of your understanding. In this case before us, I consider myself more fitted by education and habitual study deciding what is right. Mr. Darcy, Mr. William Colts of Huntsford.
Huntsford.
Who would have thought of my meeting the nephew of Lady Catherine in this private assembly?
Who indeed?
Pray do not take my absence from your aunt as any display of lackadaisical contempt for the office of clergyman.
I'm so convinced Lady Catherine's discernment to be sure she can have still a favor unworthily.
Nor can I think well of a man who would omit such an occasion of testifying his respect to anybody connected with his patron's family.
Good night, Mr. Collins.
The late Mr. Darcy was one of the best men that ever breathed.
You knew the father?
He was my godfather, and excessively attached to me. He bequeathed me the parish and the living of his estate, soon after the living fell vacant, it was given elsewhere.
Good heavens!
The church ought to have been my profession. I was not intended for the military life.
I have heard enough.
I have no right to give my opinion. His father's uncommon attachment to me irritated him. He had not the temper to bear the sort of competition in which we stood.
I suppose Mr. Darcy would be despising his fellow creatures in general. I did not think it possible for him students to be such malicious revenge in particular.
I have known Mr. Darcy too long and too well to be a fair judge.
Well, I think he's very disagreeable. He is not liked at all in Hertfordshire. Everybody is disgusted with his pride.
He's proud of his family, of Pembroke, and is a careful guardian to his sister.
What sort of girl is Mr. Darcy?
Very, very proud. As a child, she was affectionate and pleasing, and extremely fond of me. She is handsome, highly accomplished.
How can sweet Mr. Bingley be friends with such a man? He cannot know what Mr. Darcy is.
Tell me about Marysville, the neighbour, the society.
It is the most pleasant society.
It was the prospect of good and constant society which was my chief inducement to enter the regiment here. Ah, shall we dance?
Myself satisfied with my reception. Mr. Darcy seemed much pleased with the attention, though he has departed.
I could not imagine he would have left so hastily, sir.
had he not wished to avoid a certain gentleman.
Your meaning, sir?
I was not meaning you, sir. Miss Bennet, I wish to be better acquainted.
Mr. Wickham? Am I to prevail upon you to dance with me?
Mr. Collins, I entreat you to dance with somebody else. I can introduce you to any young lady in the room.
I am perfectly indifferent to dancing. My chief object is my delicate attentions to recommend myself to you.
I protest.
There is no arguing upon such a project.
So, Miss Eliza, I see you're quite delighted with George Wickham.
My acquaintance with Mr. George Wickham feels far short of delight, seemingly.
Let me recommend you as a friend not to give implicit confidence to his assertions.
His assertions?
Mr. Wickham has treated Mr. Darcy in the most infamous manner. Mr. Darcy cannot bear to hear him mentioned, let alone to see him. His coming into the county is the most insolent thing, and I wonder how he could presume to do it.
You may well wonder.
I pity you, Miss Eliza.
You're mistaken if you expect to influence me by such pity.
I beg your pardon. Excuse my interference, it was kindly meant. I sincerely hope your Christmas in Hertfordshire may abound in the gaieties that the season generally brings. I do not pretend to regret anything. I shall leave Hertfordshire except your company.
Will you all be gone?
We must leave for London tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
Mr. Darcy is impatient to see his sister, and to confess the truth, we are scarce and less eager to meet her again. I really do not think that Georgiana Darcy has her equal beauty, elegance, and accomplishments. But I do dare entertain the hope of her being my sister hereafter.
Your sister?
My brother admires her greatly already.
Oh, Elizabeth, Caroline Bingley neither expects nor wishes me to be her sister. She is perfectly convinced of her brother's indifference for me. And if she suspects the nature of my feelings for him, she means, most kindly, to put me on my guard.
On the contrary, Miss Bingley can see that her brother is in love with you, but wants him to marry Miss Darcy. None who has ever seen you two together can doubt his affection for you. If Miss Bingley had seen half as much love in Mr. Darcy for herself, she would have ordered wedding clothes.
Elizabeth!
Oh, Jane, we are not rich enough or grand enough for them.
Caroline Bingley is incapable of willfully deceiving anyone, and all I can hope for in this case is that she has deceived herself with her brother's affections for me. It is no more than an error of fancy on my side, and it brings me great comfort to know that it's done no harm to anyone but myself.
You wish to think all the world respectable. The more I see the world, the more I'm dissatisfied with it. And every day confirms my belief in the inconsistency of all human characters.
Dear Lizzie, such feelings as these will ruin your happiness. We must not be so ready to fancy ourselves intentionally injured. It is nothing but our own vanity that deceives us. Women fancy admiration means more than it does.
And men take care that they should.
She will laugh herself out of it. But do you think I might prevail upon your daughters to accompany me on my journey to the lakes?
Oh, Jane will go, not go. She has not the disposition, nor the inclination, nor the constitution. I could not bear to part with her. But take Elizabeth. She I will not miss. And you may persuade her on her error in rejecting Mr. Collins.
Look, Lizzie, you received a letter from Charlotte Lucas.
My dear Liza, I'm engaged to Mr. Collins. Be not surprised. Do not think it incredible that Mr. Collins should procure any woman's good opinion because he was not so happy to succeed with you. Mr. Collins is neither sensible nor agreeable. His society is irksome, and his attachment to me must be imaginary.
Mr. Collins, a conceited, pompous, narrow-minded, silly man.
But still, he will be my husband. Without thinking highly, neither of man nor matrimony, marriage has always been my object. It is the only honorable provision of a young, well-educated woman of small fortune. Besides, mother and father have approved of it, as is Lady Catherine de Bourgh. I know what you're thinking. You must be surprised, very much surprised, so lately as Mr. Collins was wishing to marry you. But when you have time to think it all over, I implore you to join me at my new home of Huntsford. Your dearest friend, Charlotte Lucas.
I disbelieve the whole matter. I do believe Mr. Collins has been taken in and that they will never be happy together. It is very hard for me to think that Charlotte Lucas may one day be mistress of Longbourn and that she may take my place in it.
Do not give way to such gloomy thoughts. Let us flatter ourselves that I may be the survivor. It gratifies me to discover that Charlotte Lucas, whom I believe to be tolerably sensible, is as foolish as my wife, and more foolish than my daughter.
I do not envy Miss Lucas. Mr. Collins is only a clergyman, not a soldier.
Well, ever crossed in love, I congratulate you both. Let Wickham be your man, Lizzie.
Wickham!
He is a pleasant fellow and will jilt you creditably. It is a comfort to know that your mother always knows what to do.
Now, girls, take your aunt on a turn around the garden. I must rest my nerves.
To Netherfield again, and are to give up the house.
How?
I shall not be tempted to say that there is a strong appearance of duplicity in all of this, but I will endeavour to banish every painful thought and think of only what will make me happy. Your affection and invariable kindness.
Oh, Jane.
My dearest Lizzie, you will, I'm sure, be incapable of triumphing in your better judgment at my expense when I confess myself to have been entirely deceived by Miss Bingley's regards for me. But my dear sister, do not think me obstinate if I still assert that her anxiety for her brother is the cause of it.
Mr. Bingley is not the cause, but a proud and vain man, to be sure.
Twice every week, and are never allowed to walk home.
Lady Catherine is the most respectable, sensible woman indeed, and the most attentive neighbour.
You see, Cousin Elizabeth, my dear Charlotte and I are but of one mind and one way of thinking.
Mr. Collins has surrounded me in comfort. The house, the furniture, the neighbourhood are all to my taste, and Lady Catherine's behaviour is most obliging.
Now, Cousin Elizabeth, we have been invited by Lady Catherine to spend the evening at Rose. Do not make yourself uneasy, my dear cousin, about your apparel. She will not think the worse of you for being simply dressed. But be quick. Lady Catherine very much objects to be kept waiting for her dinner. Courage!
My courage will not fail me. I'm sure I can look mistakenness of money and rank without trepidation.
Oh, Lizzie, marriage, however uncertain of giving happiness, must be the pleasantest preservative.
Charlotte, I always knew your opinions of matrimony to be not exactly like my own. Does not think it possible you giving up every bit of feeling to worldly advantage?
Not every feeling, Lizzie. But I shall not die an impoverished old maid. Neither should you.
I'd rather not think of dying, Charlotte, nor marriage. And yet there is one man to whom I've taken fancy, and he I may hope to meet.
If you mean a certain military man, then don't be such a simpleton to allow your fancy to Mr. Wickham, make you appear
to be married? Where were they educated? What was your mother's maiden name? What carriage does your father keep? Your father's estate is entailed on Mr. Collins. For your sake, Mrs. Collins, I'm glad of it, but otherwise I see no occasion for entailing estates from the female line. Do you play, Miss Bennet? Sing.
A little.
Oh, well, sometime or other we should be happy to hear you. Our instrument is a capable one, probably superior to... Mrs. Collins is welcome to come to Rosings every day and play the piano forte. She is in nobody's way. Do your sisters play and sing?
One of them does.
You ought all to have learned. Miss Wenzel play, and their father is not so good an income as yours. There are few people in England who have more true enjoyment of music than myself. If I had ever learnt, I should have been a great proficient. And so would Annabel. If her health had allowed her, she would have performed delightfully. Do you draw?
No, not at all.
What? None of you?
Not one.
Well, I suppose you had no opportunity. Your mother should have taken you to town every spring for the benefit of seeing the masters.
My mother would have had no objection, but my father hates London.
Daughters are never of so much consequence to a father. Has your governess left you?
We never had a governess.
That many daughters brought up in a home without a governess? Never heard such a thing. Your mother must have been quite a slave to your education.
I can assure you that was not the case.
Then who taught you? Who attended you? Without a governess, you must have been neglected.
Compared to some families, perhaps we were, but those of us who wished to learn never wanted the means.
Are any of your younger sisters out, Miss Bennet?
Yes, ma'am, all.
All? What? All out at once? Very odd. The younger out before the elder are married?
Well, I think it would have been very hard upon the younger not to have their fair share of society, just because the elder have not the means nor the inclination to marry early.
Upon my word, you give your opinion very decidedly for so young a person. Pray, what is your age?
With three younger sisters grown up, you can hardly expect me to admit it.
Play, Miss Bennet, play. I grow weary.
Your ladyship does me too much honour.
Nonsense, girl. Play.
Your servant, sir.
Ladies.
Annabel, take care not to exert yourself.
Miss Bennet, who would have thought you to be so accomplished up here?
You need to frighten me, Mr. Darcy, but I will not be intimidated.
I will not say that you're mistaken, because I know how you find great enjoyment in professing opinions which are in fact not your own.
I'm so very unlucky to meet with a person so well able to expose my real character in a place where I hope to pass myself off with some credit. You provoke me to retaliate. And such things will come out and will shock your relatives to hear.
I'm not afraid of you.
Of what are you talking?
I was paying Miss Bennet the compliment that her music making so properly deserves.
Miss Bennet would not play at all amiss if she practiced more and had the advantage of a London tutor.
Quite right.
Let us to dinner.
Mr. Collins appears very fortunate in his choice of a wife.
Yes, although I do not consider Charlotte marrying him the wisest thing she ever did.
It must be very agreeable to be so within so easy a distance of a family and friends.
Easy distance? It is nearly 50 miles.
And what is 50 miles of good road? A little more than half a day's journey.
Well, I've never considered distance to be one of the advantages of the match.
I suppose anything beyond the very neighborhood of Longwood would appear far to you. Are you pleased with Kent?
Yes, very. My mother would have it that everybody here is rich.
Know your family all well in Hertfordshire?
Yes, although poor for the lack of your company.
You do me too much honor, Miss Bennet.
I meant the company of your party, Mr. Darcy. Of Mr. Bingley and his sister. How very suddenly you all quit Netherfield.
Yes.
Mr. Darcy?
In vain I have struggled. My feelings will not be repressed. Therefore, you must allow me how ardently I admire and love you. All that I feel, I have long felt for you. You will no doubt feel inferior. You may sense the degradation I may feel the family obstacles. But against my reason, my will, and even my character, but I hope my feelings will now be rewarded by your acceptance of my hand.
In cases such as this, it is, I believe, the established manner to express thanks. If I could feel gratitude, I would now thank you. But I cannot. I have never desired your good opinion, and you have certainly bestowed it most unwillingly.
And this is all the reply which I am to have? are there so little endeavor at civility? Am I thus rejected?
I might as well ask why, with so evident a design of offending and insulting me, you chose to tell me you liked me against your better judgment. Was this not an excuse for incivility if I was uncivil? But I have other provocations, you know I have. Do you think that any considerations would tempt me to marry the man who's been the means of ruining, perhaps forever, the happiness of my sister?
I have no wish to deny that I did everything in my power to separate your sister from my friend, Mr. Bingley.
What right have you to decide upon the propriety of your friend's inclinations? No motive can excuse the unjust and ungenerous part you have acted. You have been the principal, if not the only means of dividing them from each other, of exposing one to the centre of the world for instability, the other to its derision for unhappy hopes, and involving them both in misery of the acutest kind. But it is not merely this affair in which my dislike is found. Your character was unfolded to me by Mr. Wickham. Yes, on this subject, what can you have to say?
You take an eager interest in that gentleman's concerns.
Who knows what his misfortunes have been, can help feeling an interest in him.
His misfortunes? Yes, his misfortunes have been very great indeed.
You have done all this. You have reduced him to his present state. You have denied him the advantages that living as a rector on your estate would bring him, and yet you can treat the mention of his misfortunes with contempt and ridicule?
And this is your opinion of me? This is the estimation which you hold me? I thank you for explaining it so fully. My faults by this calculation are very heavy indeed. But maybe these offenses might have been overlooked had not your pride been hurt by my honest confession, the scruples that so long disguised my feelings for you. But disguise of every sort is my abhorrence. I'm not ashamed of my feelings. They are honest and just. And so I ask, frankly, if you could expect me to rejoice in the inferiority of your connections, to congratulate myself on the hopes of relations whose life is so decidedly beneath my own.
Not have made me the offer of your hand in any possible way that would have tempted me to accept it. From the very beginning, from the very first moment I dare almost say of my acquaintance with you, your manners have impressed me with their arrogance, their conceit, and your selfish disdain for the feelings of others. Succeeding events increase my dislike. I have not known you a month before I felt that you were the last man on earth whom I could ever possibly marry.
You have said quite enough, madam. I perfectly comprehend your feelings, and now ashamed of my own effort. Forgive me for taking up so much of your time. Accept my best wishes for your health and happiness.